how you like sitting in your seat, if you like sitting. So I've sat over here for 2 weeks, and I'm going to tell you something. No offense, Miss Betty, but I don't like it at all the way. All right? So I'm going to quit preaching to y'all about where you sit at. The only thing I want to tell you is don't get stagnant. Don't get to where you come into a place and you're thinking, you know something, this is a place that I'm going to come in and sit, and I'm not going to feel the Spirit of the Lord. I'm not going to feel His power. Because I'm going to tell you, if you're not careful, you'll sit right where you're at. You will never listen to the Word of God. You'll never listen to His Spirit pour out on you. And you'll stay in the same condition you come in every day. So I'm about to share something with you that either every person in here has experienced or every person in here will experience. You ready to hear it? How many of y'all have ever went to an interview before? Raise your hand. Went to an interview. All right, young lady. Children, y'all look. Raise your hand again. Everybody ever went to an interview. All right, you look around. So all of you children, y'all are the ones that have not raised your hand yet. Let me explain why, because you haven't got to that point yet. But one of these days, you will. And what you'll do is you'll go to that interview. This is what you'll do. You'll go up there, you'll be nervous. If you're one of those people that chews on your fingernails, you'll chew on your fingernails before you get to that interview. You'll be nervous. You'll take your resume. Let me tell you what you'll do with your resume. You'll take that resume, and what it does is, children, it tells everything about you. It tells about where you worked before. It tells about your history. It tells about all of your accomplishments. And you know what people do? They make their resume look so good, doesn't it? Oh, and what we call it is doctoring up our resume. So what that means is we tell people what we want them to hear about us. We don't necessarily lie, but we don't fully tell the truth. You know what I mean? We tell them exactly what we want them to hear. We don't tell about the time that we got into it with our boss or our co-workers. We don't even tell about the time that we may have gotten rolled up at work. We only tell about the accomplishment. Am I right? I'm going to ask y'all again. Am I right? Exactly. That's exactly what we do. So let me tell y'all something about this. Whenever I was working at school system, my boss came to me one day and he said, hey, how would you like tomorrow for us to do interviews to teach these children how to do an interview? I said, I'd love to. He said, I'll tell you what, he said, I'll interview you. He said, you be ready for that interview tomorrow. And I said, I will. So I came in my regular work clothes, but I had him a surprise that day. That day, I came my regular work clothes, but right before our interview at 9:30, I was going to go in there, and all the class was going to be in there. I went and I changed. So what I changed into is I changed and I put on me just a t-shirt. And I put on some old pants and everything, and I put on my old work boots. Whatever I did, I put my pants down in my old work boots on one side. The other side I left out because I wanted half of me to look good and the other half not. The pants was dirty, and I'm going to tell you what I did. I borrowed from one of my students a pack of cigarettes out of their vehicle. And I put that pack of cigarettes in my shirt, and I rolled it up. And whenever I did, I got me a cap, and I put that cap on, and I put that cap sideways. So right now, every one of you are thinking, I know who you were, Brother Steve. I know who you were. Because we see people like that all the time. But I walked in there, and whenever I walked into my interview, it was the first time that morning that my boss had seen me. He was set up there in his suit and tie, and he was decked out, and I come walking in there like him. And I walked up there, and he looked at me, and it was like, what are you doing? I walked up there, and I grabbed his hand. I said, man, how you doing? I shook his hand, and he was just like, man, I hired this man. That's what he was thinking. But I sat down there, and I sat kind of slouchy in my seat that I was there. And, man, I had to say, first impression was bad. Y'all agree? Second off, my attitude was horrible. And I could go on and on and on, and all the things that we talked about in every question he asked me, he would say, you think think that you're a good boy. And I said, well, man, yeah, I think I'm a good boy. And you know something? Every word that I said, it was exactly the opposite of what it was supposed to be like. So after I got done, you know something? All the students, they were sitting there and they was laughing so much because there their teacher was acting exactly the opposite of what his boss was thinking. But about that time, here come one of my co-workers, and he came in that day, and he had a tie on. Oh, he was slicked up, had that hair slicked up to where normally that, you know, he was faking just as much as I was. When he walked in there and he sat down, and boy, he sat there and he answered everyone. First impression was good. I'm sure he had his resume doctored up the way it was supposed to be. You know, and all the thing that I thought about, he had such a great attitude, but you know what? Both of us were famous. He wasn't being himself, and I wasn't being myself. I'm not sitting there saying that I was closer to the way he was acting, but I was a long way from how I was acting. But my boss made a comment after it's over with. He said this. He said, kids, the first thing I want you to do, and he pointed over to me, is he said, I want you to make certain that you never act like that man right there did today. He said, because you'll never get the job that you don't want. He said, but then again, you don't want it. He pointed to Chris. He said, but then again, you don't want to act that fake again. See, I'm going to tell you something that's going to happen. There's a lot of people here this morning. I'm telling you, there's people in this church today, right this second, that y'all are taking your way through life. I'm even going to go further. There's people that's in here right now that you lie about who you really are. You put on a show and act like that you're something that you truly are not on a daily basis. And I'm even going to go further. There's a lot of you who've cheated to lie through. Act like that you've got everything taken care of. Actually, whenever you come in here this morning, every single person that's in this building right here, y'all look like everything's right. You're good in your life, but every one of us knows that you're lying. Every one of us knows that we're broken in some kind of way, shape, form, and fashion. Tell you, me and you are not the only two people that's broken in here that has hard times in our life. I start to say hard times. But y'all, you know something? I said in here this morning, and I said right over there, and I prayed. Now listen, all of you pray, and every one of y'all had the same prayer. Lord, give this preacher the message that we need. Listen to me. You may not need a message from me this morning. You need a message from the Lord this morning. And y'all may be sitting here right now faking being a good Christian person, whenever you may be tore up completely on the inside. So what I want you to do this morning, I want you to be real. We just say up about where you are. Whenever I listen to this and I think about this, you know, there's people also that will use the Lord's name or use the church's name to be able to get a business or get what they want. They say, oh, I go to Pocahontas Baptist Church like it's supposed to get you in a prestigious place. I'm going to tell you something. If you start looking around, there's not anything prestigious about us. The only thing different about us is that we are truly trying to learn about God, and we are truly trying to get focused on Him, and we are truly realizing where we're really at in this world. You know how I know? Because I've seen a 55-year-old man come to know the Lord whenever he'd been in church all of his life. I see a young lady, and I'm not giving into her age, but she's coming and she's telling everybody, y'all, I want you to know I'm following the Lord in baptism today because I know what I did between me and the Lord. See, what we're doing right now is all of us are trying to get real, but we got to make sure first that we're not fake. So I want y'all to look in your Bible at Titus 1. Listen to verse 16. I'm going to read this scripture. I've got a lot of scripture that I want to share with you because it's what means something to me. The Bible says they profess that they know God, but in words they deny Him, being abominable. You know, the only time I've ever heard that word abominable in my life was an abominable snowman. Has any of y'all thought about that? That's the only time that I'd ever heard that word, and I don't even remember watching it on TV whenever I was a kid, and they would day was a show at the bottom of the snowman was on, but I thought, what does that word mean? So I had to look it up. That's how silly I am. I had to look it up. And what that means is it means someone who is just bad to the core or somebody who is unimpressive in any kind of way. So the Bible says if you're being a bad person all the way to the core, and it says that disobedient, and to every good work you're a reprobate, that word reprobate means that you disqualify yourself. There's people in here that if you was to ask yourself, are you right with God, you truly disqualify yourself because you don't know about Jesus Christ. So the question I ask you is, are you truly a Christian person this morning? See, I want you to know something, that a person who loves the Lord, they put their faith in Jesus Christ. Look at verse 15. It says, but unto the pure, all things are pure. But unto them that are defiled and unbelieving, there's nothing pure, but even their mind and their conscience is defiled. I don't know about any of y'all, but I'm going to tell you where I have problems with. No, I just want anybody, if y'all want to know where the preacher's sin is, raise your hand. Y'all really want to know where my sin is? Don't lie. I know you want to know. Oh, you know why nobody raised their hand? Because if you'd have raised your hand and said, Brother Steve, I want to know where your sin is, you was thinking, what if I was to ask you, or you about your sin? But I'm going to tell you where my sin is. My sin is not always in my heart. My sin's in my mind. And the Bible is talking about that our mind defiles us. But let me tell you something. Whenever your mind tells you to do something and you don't act out on it, is it a sin? No, it's not. Whenever your mind tells you to go over there and my mind says, I want you to go down there and hit old Jimmy Weaver right there. But I'm thinking, no, that's not the right thing to do. Jesus got through teaching children's church on loving your neighbor. That's my neighbor right there. I'm not going to go and defile him in any kind of way. So I'm going to tell you what the devil says. Y'all ready? Whenever the old devil puts something on us, he attacks us in our mind. He shows us something that's a sin, that's beauty, that we behold and we look upon, but yet we don't act on it. You know what you've done? You've defeated the devil. See, but a lot of times the old devil say, oh, but you thought about it. Oh, but it was on your mind. Well, let me tell you something. There's a lot of things that I think about a lot. Praise God, I don't follow through with it. See, whenever I read all these scriptures and I think about it, we got to be careful about putting on a Christian show in the church. 2 Corinthians 11:13 says, for such are false apostles. All these people that stand up and they say that I'm a believer, that I love the Lord, you think about this. Whenever I look in here and I see the elders of this church, I see the people who stand strong every single day. These people that stand strong every day, just because you're of age, don't mean that you're living the right way. So whenever I read this scripture, it says, for such a false apostle, deceitful worker, transforming themselves into an apostle of Christ. And Jesus knew, and he noticed that not all these people knew about him, but all of us. I'm going to share with you, every one of us is going to be. As I read this scripture, I want y'all to think about this. Go to Matthew chapter 15, look at verse 7. Every one of you is going to come to an interview one of these days, but I want to share this scripture with you. All these scribes and these Pharisees, they would come to church. They would put on their best face. They would look like that they were men of God every time they came to church. But Jesus was seeing their heart and knew what they were about. But Steve, why are you telling us this? Because I want you to know something. There's one thing that I was. I was a person who was a full-blown church member. And I was lost as I could be. I was a person who would come in and I would, boy, if you interviewed me, I'd know all the right words to say. I'd know all the scripture to quote. I would know every one of the songs that we sang. There was nothing that got by me. You want to know why? Because all of my life, my parents had taught me about the Bible. All of my life, I knew what was right and what's wrong. And I was the one person that was living the wrong life, just like Jesus was talking about. have asked Jesus to come to your heart as an adult, and you know that you're right with him now. Whenever I read this scripture in Matthew chapter 15, starting with verse 7, Jesus Christ was telling these Pharisees here, the church people, he said, "You hypocrites, well did Isaiah prophesy about you, saying, people draw," here, I want you to pay attention, "people draw near unto me with their mouth, and they honor me with their lips." That means that they say all the right things, all the right time. It says, "but their heart is far from me." But it says, "but in vain do they worship me, teaching all the doctrines and commandments of men." And whenever I think about this scripture right here, listen to what it says. "And he called all the multitude unto him, and he said, I want you to all, listen, I want you to all hear and understand me. He said, it's not what goes into the mouth of a man that defiles a man, but which cometh out of the mouth, that's what defiles a man." I want y'all to know something, that there's going to be times in your life that you're going to be, when you hit that finger, and the first thing that ought to come into your mind is, what am I about to say? Every time I was at work, I would teach welding, and I've shared this with y'all before. But all of my kids, they would come with their project. And they would bring it up there, and wherever they would, I'd tell all of my students, just make sure that you take that hot piece of metal, and you stick it down in the water, and you cool it off, and you bring it to me, laid in your hand like this. And they would say, "Why do I do it? Why? Why?" Because I was the type of person that whenever somebody had done something, you know what I'd do? I'd reach and grab a hold of it. And I got scars on my hands where I would reach and touch that hot piece of metal, and it would burn my hands. And I realized that those people, it wasn't their responsibility to keep me from being hurt. It was my responsibility to make certain that I paid attention. See, I'm getting to a scripture, and I want y'all to think about that, because I want y'all to think about this interview that we're going to come in. Romans chapter 14. I'm not far from through, but y'all come to Romans chapter 14 and look at verse 9. And I want all of you to know, every one of you, all of us are going to be interviewed in these days. And every one of us is going to know whenever we're being interviewed. But y'all listen to what the Bible says. In Romans chapter 14, verse 9. "For here's the end." Pay attention. "Here is the end. Christ both died and he rose, and he revived," or he lives again. Y'all know this about God. Jesus Christ, he came to this earth and he died on Calvary's cross for every one of you. He went to that grave, and whenever he went to that grave, they sealed up that grave and they locked it up as tight as they could. But that grave couldn't hold him. And he went back into heaven, and he's alive and well today. And the Bible's telling about it, just like I'm talking to you. And it says then that he might be Lord of both the dead and living. But why do you judge? You ready? "But why do you judge your brother? Or why do you set your thoughts? Or why do you despise your brother? For we shall all stand before the judgment seat of Christ." Now, so let me tell you something. One of these days, every one of you are going to stand before the Lord. But let me tell you what you're going to do here in just a few minutes. An invitation time is going to come. Whenever that invitation time is going to come, there's some of you that the Spirit of God, it probably wasn't through this message, might have been through the song service, might have been that you've been fighting for weeks and weeks between your relationship and between you and the Lord. But here in a few minutes, this is what's going to happen. The Spirit of God is going to tell you to make a decision. It may be that you need to come to the altar and pray for your family. It may be that you need to come to the altar and pray for somebody who's lost a loved one, somebody who's hurt. You may be praying for somebody who's going to get an interview for a job. "Wait a minute, Brother Steve, you mean we pray for that?" I'm going to tell you, everything that's on your heart, you should take to the Lord and pray, no matter what it is. "My mom and daddy makes me mad." Children, go to that altar and you tell the Lord, "Lord, my mom and daddy just makes me want to just scream and holler sometimes." I'm going to tell you something, they understand. You know why? Because you're probably driving them crazy too. So all you got to do is you just need to listen. what we tend to do, a lot of times people say, "Well, Steve, I wish you would never ask me to pray out loud." And the reason that they say that is because they say, "I don't know why to pray out loud." Well, I'm going to share something with you. Right here. Come here, Oakley. Come here. See, Oakley right here, he is very smart. And I'm going to tell you something about Oakley. Oakley's one of these type people that if you're around him long, old, he's a long time. Oakley's the type of person that right off the top of his head, his mind is so quick, he's so reactive. He's one of these type of people. Am I not telling the truth? Oakley's one of those people that I tell him, I hope that one of these days he's a Christian comedian. You know why? Every word that comes out of his mouth, you can find some funniness in it. Because Oakley's always, he's always thinking. And the thing about Oakley, he's one of these type of people that while ago in church, Oakley was running around. Oh, he was wide open. He was running around. I was fine. I loved seeing him run around in church. He'd get sweating. He'd get hot. He'd come up and he'd say, "I'm sweating. I'm hot." Yeah, he just run 3 miles in church. Supposed to be hot and sweating. But you know something? I was tickled with Oakley running around until the point came that there was people in here that he could run over and hurt. So you know what I did? I looked down and I went, shook my head. And you know what Oakley did? He stopped. He's like that. You know why? Because Oakley was right in the middle. Every person in here may not be as smart as Oakley is.
Right? They don't even look as smart as you do.
Well, but the thing that you know is you know right from wrong. And if I was to ask Oakley right now, Oakley, I'd like to pray. Oakley don't have to think about what he's going to pray about. Oakley's already got it in his mind that he's going to pray for.
Who would you pray for? You got somebody?
Hold on. You're going to pray for your
mama? Who else?
Don't pray for you, Daddy.
What about this mean little brother of yours? You don't pray for him? You finally. You don't pray for Carly?
You know, there's a lot of people that Oakley's going to pray for, but I'm going to tell you what's good about Oakley. If he's not putting on the show about who he's praying for, all right? Oakley knows who he's going to pray for. Oakley, you look back. Oakley, you look back. The thing I want you to realize is this. The Bible tells us that we must come to Him as a child. And when we come to Him as a child, that means that we tell Him everything about Him. The reason that Brooke goes and gets her mom and daddy to pray is because she wants to pray with her mom and daddy. The reason that a lot of you men, I'm going to talk to men, the reason a lot of you men don't get serious and pray with your family is because you ain't practicing. The reason that you don't grab your family by their arm and you take them down to this altar, it's not because the message wasn't good. Half of them are no good. But the Spirit of God's telling you, men, go pray for your wife. Go pray for your children. Go pray for them. So where are you at this morning? See, the Bible tells us plainly that whenever the invitation comes, you know what we're going to do? We're going to start judging each other. Wonder what he's going to do that altar for. See, the Bible says, but why do you judge our brother? Or what do you set your thoughts on your brother? Or why should you stand before the judgment seat of Christ? The Bible says in verse 11, for it is written, as I live, saith the Lord, every knee is going to bow, and every tongue shall confess God. So then every one of us shall give an account to himself for God. Every one of you are going to give an account for yourself. Let me finish. Let us not therefore judge one another anymore, but judge this rather, that no man put a stumbling block on an occasion for his brother to fall. See, I want y'all to know something. How's your invitation? Your invitation's going to be, you know, I wonder why he's going to that altar. Wonder why she's going to that altar. Why does that person always go to that altar? Wonder what's in that closet that they're getting at. got one last scripture for you. 2 Corinthians 5:10. For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that every one of us may receive the things that's done in his body, whether it be good or bad. See, I want you to know something. Every person in here is going to stand before God. You're not going to get away from him. You're not going to, listen, you're not going to be able to ride mom and daddy's coattail into heaven. Don't work that way. Every one of you is going to stand before the judgment seat of Christ. I want you to think right now, what's going to be your answer whenever the Lord Jesus Christ says, why should I let you into my covenant? Oh, Lord, I have been a good person. Jesus called him hypocrite. Oh, Lord, I gave the money at church. Jesus called him a hypocrite. Oh, Lord, did I not prophesy in your name? Depart from me, you workers of iniquity. Did I not sing a special? I want you to know that special might have sounded good in this building, but it ain't right because your heart wasn't right. So here's your time to make things right between you and me. Don't leave here with this. Don't leave here because you don't know how to pray. All you got to do is just pray. Lord, I love you. Lord, I want you to touch my family. Lord, I want to be a good boy on people who don't know you. That's what you want. This is all up to you this morning. Make a decision for you. Lord, I come to you. And every person in here right now, they're thinking, I don't want to go that far. I don't want to be saved in front of these people. I don't want the Lord to be convicted of me openly because I don't know what to say to that preacher. Lord, I don't want to pray in front of my family. Lord, I don't want them. We can make every excuse we want to God, but I pray that every person here will take a look at their heart and say, put it out with you. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen. Altar's open.